There's that, and let me just, I got a little rat knot. So what are you doing? You're going to be doing basketball again this year?
I don't know if there's going to be any basketball, so I'll pop in there when...
When it's time to know?
Yeah.
When it's time to be in the know? Come on, Mike.
Take your time, man.
I'm good. I have a free... So just go off.
Yeah, I'm going to go. Unknotted as possible. Okay. I don't want to get in the way of your camera. Okay, cool. So that gives me some flexibility, because then...
Hey, WonderLab crew. My name is Jaren, and I was a volunteer assistant from 2007 to 2010 when I was a student at IU. And I just wanted to say just how important and impactful it was, my experience at WonderLab, and making sure that I had a career where I could have fun and also be impactful, and also where I could work at a place that has a cool apron. So I just want to say thank you for everybody for forming my career and making sure that I love my job. Thank you.
Hi, my name is Cassie Johnston, and I was a WonderLab marketing intern from 2003 through 2005. And the skills I learned being part of the WonderLab team directly impacted where I was throughout my career and eventually helped me get to where I am now, which is owner of my own company. I run my own digital publishing company. I think what was so wonderful about my time at WonderLab was, since this team was so small and tight-knit, everyone had to wear a ton of different hats, and it meant that I got to learn skills that were outside of what I was learning in the classroom. It was practical stuff about how to work within a budget, work within a timeline, work with a group of people, work with the public, and those are all the kind of skills that when I went into my first job interview after college, the people interviewing me were incredibly impressed that I could hit the ground running, because those were the kind of skills that not everyone was coming out of college with. And so those kind of skills, those practical skills were able to really jump me forward in my career, get me to the point where I could start my own business. And I am just eternally grateful for my time at WonderLab. I had so much fun. I consider everyone their friends, and I look back at my time just super incredibly fondly, and I'm so grateful I took that first day and went and did that internship. It was just an absolutely wonderful experience for me personally and for my career.
Hello and welcome to Science Night Out. I hope you all are enjoying yourselves this evening. My name is Carly Fields and I am a fiber artist and clothing designer, and I'm here to talk to you tonight about a temperature blanket. We currently have one for our silent auction tonight that I made for Bloomington specifically for 2019. The one I have right now that I'm going to show you is current temperature blanket. So the idea behind a temperature blanket is to create a visual representation of a set of data. The data chosen is the average daily temperature in a given location. So the one I'm working on right now actually does the high and the low of each day. So each color represents 12 degrees, and I have 9 colors in this blanket. So what that kind of looks like close up, we have one stripe that is all blue. And that means both colors that I chose, the high and the low, are between 28 and 39 degrees. So you can see kind of the homogeneity that happens there. Right next to it, the day before, is a yellow and blue stripe. And so that signifies that that day had a variance of about 40 degrees. So when it all comes together, you get a really interesting visual representation of Bloomington throughout its weather. Now, what I love about these kinds of projects is that it marries art and science. We're often given this idea of a false dichotomy, that you have arts over here and you have science over here. But what's really interesting and beautiful is when you can take that science and turn it into a beautiful piece of art. I think we're better together. We use all of our skills to create something beautiful. And it's even better when you can take your artwork at the end of the day and snuggle up underneath it.
Hi, everybody. I'm Beth Raff. I'm the Vice President of the WonderLab Board of Directors. And I'm here today to show you the process for bidding in the silent auction using your phone. We all have our phones. And between you and me, I think they picked me to show you how to do this. Because if I can do it, you can too. Okay, so when you signed up, when you got your ticket to the gala, you will have gotten a text from GiveSmart, the company that's doing the helping support the gala. And so go to that thread, and the thread is entitled by the number. It comes from 762-778. So click on that thread, and then the first text you got thanks you for getting your ticket, and you can, it gives you a link if you want more details about the gala, and that would be great to click on. But the second text is the one we're talking about today. So, and that says, starting September 2, the Gala Silent Auction is now open for WonderLab. And so go to that link, it will appear on your phone, and you'll start seeing items. For instance, in the right-hand corner is a Trek bike and accessories. And I wanna tell you, the silent auction items are just terrific. So look at them all before you decide what to bid on, and then bid on lots of them. Okay, so now you can scroll down. Just once you're on that screen, you're really home free, because any item that you wish to bid on, just touch it, goes to the link to that, and you can enter your bid. But there are a few more wrinkles that we can look at. So once you get here to the items, as you scroll down, pretty soon you'll come to a logo for one of our sponsors. And the logos of our sponsors sort of appear and in different rotational orders in here, because we want to thank our sponsors. And so as you scroll by those links, give a thanks to our sponsors. They're great. So, but when you get to that first sponsor logo, don't quit scrolling, because there's more items under. And keep going down and down and down. We have lots of items in the silent auction. And I'll just keep scrolling till you get to the very bottom. I'm just going to say one more thing. When you get to the bottom, there are green bands across that are like filters, so you can see different categories of items. As for example, the very last category is tasty treats. So let's try that one. We go to tasty treats, and that pops up the four wonderful tasty treats that you can bid on in the silent auction. But then you always have the choice of going back to all items. So we're looking forward to seeing you, even if in 2D, at the gala. And please don't forget, keep bidding in the silent auction. Thanks. Bye.
William, you might notice she doesn't have any ears. Or does she? Let's take a closer look.
It sounded really nice.
Thank you.
You know what I really like about the trumpet?
What's that?
I like the way that when you blow air in, it activates a standing wave inside the bent tubing of the instrument, and that produces the sound that comes out of the bell. Would you like some lemonade?
Sure.
How about a little tea in your lemonade?
Of course.
I have this nice dark blue tea here.
Oh, that's pretty.
That's chemistry.
My name is Sarah Lynn Wells, and I'm a museum educator at WonderLab Museum. Today I'm going to show you an activity that you can do at home with just a couple of items to experiment with sound waves. The first thing you want to do is go to your kitchen and grab a spoon. Doesn't matter, you could do something as small as a teaspoon or as large as a ladle. You just want to make sure it's a metal spoon. Next, check your swag box and you should have some twine. We're going to attach this to our spoons. So what I'm going to do, if you have a spoon that has some sort of cutout or is it really easy, you can just thread that right through. Mine doesn't have that, so I'm going to show you a really easy way to go ahead and attach that twine to your spoon. I have it folded in half, so it makes a nice little loop here. I'm just going to carefully pull the other end through. Sometimes if you do it too quickly, it starts to pull off of the spoon. But once I tighten it, it makes it to where I've got a nice connection there, and it's gonna hold on to my spoon. So now I have some twine with a metal spoon attached. So now you wanna make sure that you are near some sort of hard surface. I'm sitting at a table, so this is perfect for our activity. You could also use the back of a chair or something else like that. You just want to make sure it's a metal spoon and it's hitting against a hard surface. All right, so what we're going to do now is I am going to wrap the ends of my twine. It doesn't have to be at the very end, but I'm going to wrap it around my pointer finger a few times. I just want to make sure I've wrapped that twine around my finger a few different times. So now what I'm going to do is I'm going to put my fingers in my ear. Much like putting some headphones in, and I'm going to gently tap my spoon against the hard surface. Like I said, I've got a table right here, so that works perfectly. But you want to make sure as you are hitting the spoon against the hard surface, you're keeping your fingers attached in your ear. Now, you might have been able to hear the spoon hitting against the table, but you can't hear exactly what I was hearing. When you do that, you're probably familiar with what a spoon is going to sound like against a table. But when you do it that way, you're going to hear something very different. What you are hearing and experiencing through this experiment is learning a little bit more about sound waves. Now, you may know that sound waves are due to vibration. When that spoon is hitting that hard surface, there's a vibration, and that creates sound and that we end up hearing. Sound waves typically travel through the air. But in this experiment, the spoon, when it begins to vibrate against the hard surface, it begins to have vibration. That vibration continues through the string and through your finger into your ear. So rather than hearing the sound from sound waves that are traveling through the air, You are actually hearing the sounds by sound waves and vibration that's traveling through the string. And it's really interesting because sound waves travel differently through a solid than they do through a gas like the air. So this is a great way to see the difference between what it sounds like if I hit this spoon against the table and hear that vibration through the air, through the sound waves traveling through the air, versus if I hear that through the sound traveling through the string. So just a great way to hear the difference between how sound waves travel through solids versus through gases.
So what do you guys love about WonderLab?
Snakes! Oh, Jordan, my favorite thing, my really, really favorite thing, it's the where you get to put the animals in the basket and then reel them up.
Oh, yeah, in the play, in the kids' play area.
Yeah, I like that too, and I like the big bubble thing.
The giant bubble maker?
Yeah.
Yeah, that's pretty cool.
And then I also like the water table with all the little fountains. Because I like to put my fingers up against the glass cut and then let the water run down my fingers.
Oh.
Jackson, what is science?
Science is the study of everything and how everything works.
What I like most about science is without it, anybody would barely know anything. And I guess what I like about to WonderLab is the fossil dig. And in WonderLab, they can teach you a bunch of cool stuff. And they have a bunch of fun stuff like mazes and dinosaur digs. And it's very fun.
We need science to cure diseases like COVID. They'll find a vaccine sometime soon, I just know it. At WonderLab in Bloomington, I know you'll have a fun time. All it takes to love it is just to go one time.
Hello, everyone. Good evening. Greetings from WonderLab. I'm Karen Jepson-Ennis, Executive Director, and I couldn't be happier to welcome you to WonderLab Science Night in Gala Fundraiser, the Sound of Science. When I was thinking about what to say to you this evening, it kept coming back to just one word, gratitude. I am so grateful that WonderLab is open again. So that we can hear the sounds of kids playing on our exhibits and see those families who tell us over and over again that their kids wake up every morning and say they want to go to WonderLab to learn about science. I'm so grateful to our staff who have found many creative ways to connect with our community during the time we were closed, from serving over 500 families through online programming to writing 5 new federal partnership grants with our IU research partners, to serving 40 teachers this summer at our Summer Teacher Institute. I'm grateful for all of those generous grants, loans, and donations that helped us keep our awesome staff, make changes to our building and our operations, and challenges ahead. Due to the COVID shutdown and the loss of revenue during our busiest and most profitable season, we're projected to end the year with a funding gap of $143,000. That's a really big number. So our goal tonight is to put a big dent in that number so that WonderLab can keep helping kids be passionate learners and become curious, creative problem solvers, because we'll need them for the future. So now, check your phones and bid high and often on all of the amazing things tonight, and have fun.
With that secret knowledge. It's that feeling of discovery that drew me to science and that keeps me in science. That wonder that Hello, my name is Irene Newton, and I am an associate professor of biology at Indiana University in Bloomington. In my laboratory, we study host-microbe interactions, how microbes interact with their hosts and change their biology. This is something especially relevant to think about right now. In this moment, the entire world has discovered that a small bit of RNA can have a devastating effect on our economies and on our health, causing phenomenal devastation. The microbes I study in my lab are those that are beneficial to their hosts, that provide them with nutrients, and that protect them from invading pathogens. As a scientist, what has drawn me to science is the ability to make observations about the world, to form a hypothesis grounded in those observations, and to perform controlled experiments to test that hypothesis. And in that moment, when I analyze the data for the first time and discover something new, a new result, that moment is one in which I am the only person in the world with that secret knowledge. It's that feeling of discovery that drew me to science and that keeps me in science. That wonder that I felt as a young student discovering something new about the world around me is what drew me to science and what has kept me in it. And this is what WonderLab does for our kids every day. The moments of discovery that kids experience at WonderLab help them to appreciate and understand how science plays a role in their everyday lives. It is not something separate, it is not something apart, but indeed central to their life. For example, the technology that powers their class, their fermentative microbes that make the cheese on their pizza, even the eusocial insect that makes the honey for their breakfast, all these things are science. We need museums, especially science museums, now more than ever. These museums educate and cultivate critical thinking skills that allow us and our kids to identify what is real and what is not. This is an especially important skill in our current times. Let us support WonderLab and teach our kids to think for themselves and to inspire them to tackle the biggest problems facing our society now. Thank you for listening to me, and thank you for your support of WonderLab.
I'm here today with the WonderLab beehive, and I'm hearing lots of buzzing coming from the colony. Now, bees make this noise by beating their wings at speeds of up to 200 times every single second. These noisy vibrations are helpful for an essential ecological role that bees play. But for that, we're gonna have to head outside to the Wonder Garden.
Bees are incredibly important pollinators, and when visiting flowers, some bees utilize the sound waves coming off of their beating wings to shake off extra pollen. The pollen lands on the bee's body and is transported to the next flower that the bee lands on, utilizing sound to create new life.
Thanks, Hunter. Hunter Miller turns out to be a really great video personality, although we didn't hire him for that job. And Hunter is not unique. Every single WonderLab staff person has reinvented their jobs over and over again during the shutdown time, and I could not be more proud of each and every one of you. So, wherever you are out there, WonderLab staff, stand up, three cheers to you. And I can't go any farther tonight without thanking our amazing Gala committee, whose creativity and tireless work brought this event to us tonight. So I'll start with Megan Rothrock, our Gala chairperson. Going on, there's Asha Kirchhoff, Ashley Johnson, Caitlin Keller, Carly Fields, Dion Cross Francis, Amy Osajima, and Megan Thompson. Stand up wherever you are, three cheers for you. WonderLab is also really fortunate to have an engaged and dedicated board of directors, many of whom are out there somewhere this evening. So I hope you will all raise a glass to all of these remarkable people. Thank you all.
The top underneath a tight turn. It's one more tight corner. Molly has to pry herself up. She can see the bell. She needs to ring to finish. As she gets closer to the top, one stretch, and Molly has done it. Molly Kate, congratulations. That's our first contestant.
Before I want to introduce this evening's speaker, I want to be sure and thank our generous sponsors, and I hope that you all will too when you're out and about in the community. They are Herlow Wealth Management Group, Slotograph Niehoff, Old National Bank, First Insurance Group, Liberty Farm Dentistry, Lauren Wood Builders, BKD CPAs and Advisors, Bloomington Oral Surgery, Boston Scientific, Commercial Service, Dr. K. Luke Eads, Family Dentistry, F.C. Tucker, Bloomington Realty, Innovative Financial Solutions, Quality Mill Supply, Bill C. Brown Associates, Blue & Company, LLC, Sterling Lab, from the very beginning, and the importance of making science fun and memorable. At WonderLab's very first gala many years ago, he put the mayor of Bloomington on a bed of real nails and broke a concrete block over his chest to demonstrate the physical principles of force and pressure. Everyone was fine. Rick led a team of undergraduate students to create and install a cosmic ray telescope at the new WonderLab, and that's still working today. Rick has remained a popular presenter at WonderLab's teacher workshops over the last 15 years. He's been a longtime friend, an advocate for WonderLab, and is currently on our board of directors. So I'm now going to turn it over to Rick, who's going to tell you about rumbling resonances from spooky hauntings to Lotus Fest.
Hi, I'm Rick Van Kooten. I'm a physics professor at Indiana University Bloomington. I'm also the executive dean of the College of Arts and Sciences. That's my day job now. My research is normally in experimental particle physics, so working at these gigantic facilities, first outside of Chicago, Fermilab, and then outside of Geneva, Switzerland, smashing particles together and see what happens. I've also for quite a few times taught the physics of sound in the department. And as a result of it, I've had a lot of undergrads working on small tabletop experiments, like very different from my main line of research, in acoustics. And so I've also sort of developed a hobby of acoustics and being interested in sound. So I'll be talking about today sound very quickly in general, and also talking about resonances and how they lead to these two different topics of hauntings and what you might hear in a given year at Lotus Fest. I'm going to talk and discuss sound in tubes or in columns of air. For example, if I have this tube and I bop it on the end, the sound it makes.
This is an animation where the points or the dots represent either an air molecule or a patch of air. I'm going to provide a pulse, just like we did at the beginning where we bopped the tube. And you can see a area of compression or higher pressure followed by an area of what's called rarefaction, where the air molecules are spread further apart. That's a sound pulse traveling at the speed of sound down the tube. Now, this animation shows that we can excite the tube or sound in the tube by a smoothly varying sinusoidal excitation. And you can see in the top, again, a wave, sound waves moving down the tube. Now, talking about the concept of resonance, a classic example is pushing a swing. If you push a swing just at the right frequency, every time they come back, you push it. And if you keep pushing it at the right time, the right frequency, you hit a resonance and your child goes higher and higher and higher and giggles with glee. Now you could think of the same way of a resonance in a tube. For example, if you have a sound pulse going back, now hit it at just the right time, bop, bop, bop. That sound pulse will keep getting louder and louder and louder. And so you've excited a resonance, and the frequency at which you have to slap the tube is essentially how long it takes to get the end of the tube and back, the speed of sound and air there and back. Now, as the tube gets longer, the frequency, the length of time it gets there and back is longer and longer. So the longer the tube, the lower the pitch of the resonance. Now, when you hit resonance, the oscillations of the air molecules look like this. And we want to consider this for when we look at different types of resonance a little bit later. A great example of this are the giant xylopipes in WonderLab. You can see that these are pipes of different length, and the longer ones have lower pitches, the shorter ones have higher pitches. So I'm going to play a song. And the same is true of organ pipes. Now, the range of frequency of hearing for adults is roughly between 30 hertz and some like 15,000 to 16,000 hertz. Any sound below around 30 hertz is not perceived as a tone. It's, it's a vibration, it's still a sound wave, but it sort of vibrates parts of your body. And there's a lot of evidence that vibrations or sound infrasound at these frequencies make you feel uneasy. And a very interesting experiment was done in the UK where scientists in a concert hall in the basement had a long sewer pipe, 66 meters long, where they drove it with a subwoofer to get a resonance, like I showed before, of 17.4 hertz. The resonance provided a very high level of this sound. And what they would do is that they'd have controls where they wouldn't play this tone and have a concert upstairs. And it was very upbeat music, and they would actually survey the people, ask them, how did the music make you feel? And there's a lot of reports, made them happy, made them cheerful. And then sort of random concerts, they would turn on the 17.4 hertz and do the same thing. Ask give them the survey, ask how they made them, how it made them feel. And they would report, again, these sensations of feeling uneasy, that the hairs on the back of their neck would stand up, they'd feel chills down their spine, they'd just feel nervous looking around at what was going on. They perceived the music differently because of these sensations. What is interesting is that also in the largest cathedrals have gigantic pipe organs that actually have pipes long enough to produce notes of 16 hertz. And there's also evidence that when you're listening to music or organ music in these gigantic cathedrals and they're playing these very low notes, again, you're not hearing them as a tone, you also get sensations which are unusual. And it can be open to interpretation. And sometimes people have spiritual feelings in the presence of such infrasound. And this leads us to the next, you know, where the purported hauntings in some cases. There in fact been numerous cases of infrasound being responsible for what people thought were hauntings, including this peer-reviewed study in this journal article by Vic Tandy. In that case, it was a 19 hertz infrasound that was pervading actually this laboratory where the scientist was working on and was trying to investigate what was the source of this, where there is a unbalanced fan that was resonating in this long corridor, and that people working there was driving them nuts because, again, just sensory phenomena that, particularly when they're late at night, they would actually have sensations that they thought of in the presence of a ghost. There's also this interesting where there's resonance of different parts of your body. Your lungs resonate at low frequencies. A really classic one is your eyeball will resonate at around 19 hertz. It's filled with liquid, so it's even though it's small, it resonates at low frequencies. And when you vibrate an eye like that, sometimes you get gray images off to the side that people have interpreted as ghosts. So that long corridors being excited by the wind blowing past an open window, again, exciting a resonance in a hallway where if people stood at a certain place, they'd feel chills. Again, think it's a ghost, but it was really infrasound. Now, there are different ways to set up resonances inside of tubes. We already have seen this top one called the fundamental. Now there's more complicated patterns of frequencies that will also provide resonances in a tube in this case, which is open on both ends. And I'll show an animation. The top one is the fundamental, which is what you get if you bop the tube that I showed previously. And you can see more complicated patterns that also will resonate in that same tube. What's interesting is that they'll be at frequencies which are exact multiples of the fundamental. So twice this one, you can see that this one's going back and forth at twice the frequency, and this one at three times the frequency. And in general, when you have a sound, you have a complex sound. You have all these different resonances and harmonics at the same time. Now let's analyze a very distinctive sound, like pouring yourself a tall, cold glass of beer. So the water column goes up. As it goes up, the air column above it, it's like the equivalent of a pipe, getting shorter and shorter, and so that you hear the frequency go up in pitch as the cylinder fills up. Now we're going to analyze it using a spectrogram shown here, and birders may be familiar with these. They'd often use that to show the characteristic trilling or warbling of a bird. What it is along this horizontal axis is time. This is about 8 seconds. And this vertical axis is frequency from 0 to 4,000 hertz. So where you see a band indicates an enhancement of that frequency or a resonance. And the fact that you see these different bands regularly spaced shows those harmonics, those multiples of frequencies as you go up. And as you can see, the frequencies go up from that sound. So let's play the sound on this from that previous filling up yourself a cold beer. So now what we're getting at is the last topic, and that's if you're at Lotus Fest and you see somebody actually throat singing. And what this involves is that there's a column of air above your vocal cords that actually provide a very buzzy sound. And vowels and your whole speech mechanism has to do with various orientations or changing of this column of air above the vocal cords. So it's your pharynx, your oral cavity. This opens up, and then actually you can have resonances in your nasal cavity. An example of this is showing just saying the vowel ah. So when you're saying ah, this closes off, and you get different lengths, you get different resonances in your vocal tract. Every two or three years at the Lotus Festival, there's usually a group that headlines at least one or more throat singers. It's part of the culture of Tuva, a country just north of Mongolia and parts of Mongolia, where they spend decades learning how to do this, the singing. And I'm going to show you a snippet of Siget throat singing style. And I was very, very excited looking up the schedule for this this coming virtual Lotus Festival. There's this group, Hunher Tu, which features somebody who does this very, very well. I'm going to play this, and I want to emphasize this is only this one person singing, no instruments, no accompanying instruments, is that they are able to control their vocal cords, I mean their vocal tract, in such a way that they can dampen the fundamental. You hear something very guttural, that's the fundamental, and then really emphasize the higher harmonics, the fifth, sixth, or seventh harmonics. What you'll hear is a flute-like sound that is not an instrument, it's his voice. And sometimes it's called polyphonic singing for that reason. Let's take a look of a spectrogram of a different snippet of Siget singing. You will see again, this is time, this is frequency. You can see these really strong bands, which are those flute-like sounds shown here and here, and then even at these very, very high frequencies above 5,000 hertz. This goes up to 8,000 hertz. You'll see hardly any of the fundamental and a lot of power intensity in these. And actually, when I'm at these live Lotus Fest performances, I'm often sitting with my phone, you know, looking at the spectrum as they're singing, just my wife rolls her eyes. But I really do get a kick out of this. You can track the melody going up and down, down, up again. And now we're going to go and just look at this one snippet where it's kind of constant sound. And we're going to analyze the frequency in that snippet. So here are the different peaks. And we're going to just play that single frequency. Turn up your volume if you can. The second peak. Now really crank your volume. This one's really hard to hear. Okay, you may not have heard that last one.
So with that, I hope you enjoyed these little tidbits driven by resonance and the science of acoustics. And thank you very much for having me, and enjoy the rest of your science night in. Take care, be healthy.
Hey folks, we're having a great time down here at WonderLab. There's just a couple of us in here tonight, but what a cool place. And what a fun event. Normally, as everyone knows, we have this gala every year, and it's been going on since, we were talking about it earlier today, since back in 1997, and I've been involved with it almost every year since. And this is quite an opportunity to host the first virtual. We're having the first virtual event here tonight. But let's keep in mind all this fun we're having. Molly racing to the top of this this beanstalk behind me. All that's great and that's fun. But one of our main reasons for being here tonight is to raise funds. We've got to raise funds to keep the doors open. We've got big gap to bridge, and here's what our goal is this evening. And you've got the opportunity right on your tablet, on your phone, whatever you're using, to make donations. So for the next 30 minutes, 30, 35, 32 minutes looks like, We're going to be in the middle of our fund-a-need section. Most of you remember what the fund-a-need section is. This is the part where I really want to ask you to dig deep in your heart, dig deep in your wallet, and help us maintain the WonderLab we all know and love, and the kids like Molly can keep climbing the beanstalk. So here's our goal. We've got a $50,000 goal this year for the next 32 minutes. And I need your help to make that happen. And I just, right before I went live, I got word that we've got a match, okay? I've got a $5,000 match from Dr. Steiner. Dr. Steiner wants you to donate $5,000 and he's gonna match a $5,000. So someone out there, get on your tablet. I'm gonna check off right now and we're gonna see another climber, but I'm gonna check back in here in a minute. I'm gonna look at the tablets and I'm gonna see. And we want you to also donate and help us reach that match. So we need another 5,000 match out there. Thank you.
And thank you, Jimmy Dean. And now it is time for our climber number two in the Grapevine Challenge. Molly Kate stands about 4 feet tall, but Dr. Bryce McKee is about 6 feet tall. Let's see how the doctor can navigate Grapevine Challenge number two, in 3, 2, 1. Dr. McKee, let's see it. He is moving his way up on his belly. The first turn is a very tough turn, but the doctor, who is a skinny doctor, that's the good news, he's fighting his way up. He's going to have to twist and turn a little bit because some of these turns aren't for big folks. He is now on his back, finds his way to his knees, pulling through the mesh wires, and up to the top. Molly Kate went in 44. Can the doctor beat it? He can see the finish line from here, but he has some twists and turns left to go. Are you breathing heavy, Doc? He has two masks on. That has to count for something. The bell is right around the corner. He looks like a snake. Are you a snake doctor? A snake charmer? He sees the bell and rings it. And that is contestant number two in the great.
All right, what a great run by the doctor. Now we know that we've got big and little kids alike, and they're all having fun here at the Wonder Lab. I tell you, all the parents have as much fun here as the kids. I know they do. Been here, seen it. And hey, you guys are doing good. Get back on there. Here's a fundraising update for you real quick. We've got that match. I still need you to match him at $5,000. He's sitting there waiting. Also, I just got word, I've got another match of $3,000. So if you can match that $3,000, we've got someone else sitting out there that the board has helped me with that's ready to match $3,000. So I need a $3,000 donation. Jump in there.
And I'm joined by Gabe Lubell. And today we're going to talk to you a little bit about the workings of and the physics behind this curious and quirky little instrument. So I'll start off just by telling you a little bit about how sound is made on the theremin. The actual mechanism of playing the instrument is pretty straightforward. We have a vertical antenna over here, and we have a horizontal antenna coming out over here. You can't see this right now, but it's actually a loop. This antenna controls the pitch, so the closer I get to it, higher the pitch gets, and vice versa. The antenna over here controls the volume. The closer I get to the volume antenna, the more the volume goes down to zero. So louder and softer. So that's the basic mechanism of playing the theremin.
Now those basic mechanics tie to one of two important physical phenomena that actually generate the sound. So this first effect that's related to the distance between the antenna interacts with an electronic phenomenon called capacitance. Capacitance deals with the kind of storing up of electrical charge within two separate physical objects. So in the case of the theremin, each antenna acts as one part of a capacitor. The hand acts as a moving part, a moving second part of the capacitor. And what happens is that the instrument creates an electrical charge inside the antenna. And then as the hand moves closer, the antenna kind of induces a charge in the hand. And how much of a charge it induces depends on how close or far away the hand is from the antenna. So moving the hand, therefore, kind of changes the information that's received on the inside of the instrument. The higher or lower the capacitance based on the separation of the antenna or the hand gives the instrument something to use in order to then generate sound. Now, how it actually creates the sound is another story. There's some other electrical phenomena that go on inside the instrument that are necessary to take that pure capacitance information and translate it into musical sound. But before we get into that, Kyle, why don't you tell us a little bit more about how you actually think musically about these interactions?
Yeah, so the way that I tend to think of the instrument is I imagine that there's a string, like a violin string, extending from the pitch antenna all the way across my body to the left. And just like a violin string, the closer I get to the antenna, the higher the pitch gets, just like you get with a violin bridge, right? It's also the case that the closer you get to the antenna, the closer the notes get to one another. So it means that playing high on the theremin requires a very, very high degree of control, of physical control. So one of the things that string players have learned, and I've learned this too on the theremin, is that you can mask a lot of the pitch difficulty through the use of vibrato. So I'm going to put my hand in the electrical field, and you notice that no matter how steady I try to keep my hand, the pitch is gonna vary quite a bit. So it doesn't look like I'm moving, but you hear fluctuations in pitch. So I can mask those a little bit by, just like the human voice or a violin uses vibrato. And of course, to play repeated notes at all, you need to lift your hand off the volume and put it back again. So you can't just repeat a note unless you physically stop the sound with the volume loop, so. Something like that. So that's the basic mechanism of playing the instrument.
Now, on the inside, in order to actually generate the sound, you need another electrical phenomenon, and that's the phenomenon of inductance. The basic idea of inductance is that if you run an electrical current through, say, a coiled wire, it will actually create a magnetic field that has the effect of kind of dampening down the flow of electricity. So it turns out that when you attach a capacitor, like you have with the hands of the antennas, to an inductor, the two can actually work together to create this kind of ebb and flow of electricity in one direction and then in the other. So you would say build up charge in the capacitor, and while you're building up charge in the capacitor, that affects the inductor that then wants to kind of draw the charge in the opposite direction. But drawing it in the opposite direction turns the capacitor back on and makes it want to do what it wants to do. So putting these two things together, you start to get a cycling system where electricity moves back and forth between the inductor and the capacitor, back and forth over and over again. Now, anytime we have something that operates in this kind of flip-flopping periodic way, that makes us think of waves. And it turns out that a wave in electronics behaves basically the same way as a wave does in sound, right? In physics, a wave is a wave is a wave. So between these two fairly basic electrical concepts, you have a way of creating something periodic. The problem, though, is that the frequency of the waves we get from the basic capacitor and inductor don't happen within the range of human hearing. So you need some other electronics on the inside of the instrument to actually then turn it into sound. Now, that electronics becomes like really complicated, and there are a number of ways of actually doing that exercise of transferring the frequency range. But it turns out that that specific process of transposing the frequency into the audible range is what gives the theremin its actual sound. That's what gives it the characteristic qualities that we've come to associate with it. It's kind of, you know, ethereal, detached kind of a sound. It's all happening as a sort of magical process inside the instrument.
It's a lot like the human voice in that there is no observable physical relationship between pitches, right? So I don't know from here where the next note is going to be. So there are a lot of variables that go into the sound, and one really has to use one's ear even to play something as simple as a scale. So that was not a terribly good scale from me because I don't have a lot of experience on the instrument. But this kind of thing really makes you appreciate all of the work, all of the internal work that our brain does and our ear does just to produce a steady set of pitches.
And I think that that idea of this being an instrument that draws your attention to what goes on in the mind, in the imagination, has also been part of the fascination from composers and how they have used this instrument. So it's not a particularly common instrument in classical music, but every time it has been used, it's been used to kind of convey these ideas, this idea of music coming from technology, music coming from the mind and imagination. And this is part of why where it's found maybe its most welcome home has been in soundtracks and the world of sci-fi and fantasy, precisely because it kind of interacts with you know, sort of the action of the imagination, right? It's not something you have to touch. It's something that you can just sort of use your mind to sort of induce into the world or out of it as it may be. So Kyle, why don't you do that for us? Take us away.
I'll take us home with the sound of a UFO taking off into the deepest recesses of space here. So.
All right, folks. Here we are back again. Back at the fundraising part. We're getting ready now to start with the live auction. Live auction, you say, and you're sitting there virtually. It's a virtual live auction. That's right. So the first item that we're going to sell, and you're going to bid right on your tablet, right on your phone, your computer, whatever device you're working on, whatever you're logged in with, but through the GiveSmart app, we're going to bid on lot 301, which is the little 500 bicycle. This is an authentic little 500 bicycle made just for participants in the Bloomington's famous bicycle race, made popular by the 1979 classic film, Breaking Away. Many of us around the city were there during that filming, myself included. I saw that happen, take place. This bicycle was built for the little 500, and all of them are visually identical. But this is a 500, little 500 bicycle, and I believe this is a women's race bike. So that would be the Mini, is that right? Is that? And right here it is in person. So as soon as I see some bidding coming, you're fine, it's fine. We're ready to bid on this bicycle. So what do you want to get for it? You tell me, bid on it, who get 500? 500, where to get 500? 500, where to get 500? 500, 200, bid on the bicycle online, who give $200? 200, $200, who said $100 bid? Put me on the money, $100 where? $100 where? who give $100? Either my app's not working or you're not bidding, because I'm not seeing it on my screen. So stand by, we may be having a little technical difficulty. Hundreds, fine.
Okay, it's
100. Who give 120? Who's 120? $100. Now 120. They're working on the technology, so you bid away. I'm at $100. 120. 120. Everybody give 120. There is the button that I needed. They just showed me the button I needed. Okay, the bid is the bid now currently at 300, Amy? 400. Who give 500? 400, now five. 400, would to get 500? 400, would to get 500 out of the mum pie, would to get 500, would to get 500? I'm bid 400, now five. 400, would to get 500, would to get 500, would to get 500? 400, to get 500? 500 is what I'm asking for the little 500 women's bike here. There's 450, now 500. 450, now 500. 450, everybody get 500, everybody get 500. I'm bid $450. Who get 500? 450, now five. 450, now five. 450, everybody get 500, everybody get 500. Who said 500? I'm bid 450, everybody get 500, everybody get 500, everybody get 500. There we got five, now 50. I'm bid 500, now 50. 500, now 50. Who'll get 50? 550, 50, till you get 550. I'm bid 500, wanna bid 550. I'm bid 500, wanna bid 550, till you get 550, 50, till you get 550. I'm bid 500, now 50. 500, would you get 550? 550, till you get 550. Current bid right now, 502. Would you give 525? $525, anybody? Last call for $525. Current bid's at 503. 503. You're playing the dollar game on me here. Who give $520? 520. 550. Now 75. I'm bid 550. Who give 575? 550. Everybody get 575. Everybody get 75. Everybody get 75. 575. 550 is the bid. Who give 575? Last call on the women's bicycle, little five. I'm at 550. Who give 575? 575? Anybody else? Sold at $550. Sold at $550. Now we're going to move right on to the next item. And that's item number 302 in your programs. And this is the Hoosier basketball, the IU basketball season tickets. So Indiana, we're proud for all of you, and we're proud of you all. Put on your candy stripe pants for the Indiana University men's basketball upcoming season. This package will include two 2020 through 2021 Indiana University basketball season tickets to every game, plus the season openers. Watch the games at the iconic Assembly Hall. Witness the Hoosiers take on Big Ten rivals here in Bloomington. And you're also going to get a parking pass. And in the event the season has to be canceled, this package will redeem for the 2021-22 season. Okay? So there's no risk here. Now I need the next one up on my screen for lot 302 for the Hoosier basketball. Who give $500 for that one? Somebody start me out at $500 on the basketball package. $500. Who give $500? Give $200 then. Who give $200? $200 on the basketball package. $200. Somebody place a bid on the basketball package. Who give $100? Start me and go. $100 where? If you're bidding, it's not coming through my screen again. So bear with us. On the basketball package. Amy, do they have anyone? Stand by, folks, while we get there. Okay, now it just pops up. The IU basketball tickets, there we've got 50. Now 100. 50. Who give 100? I'm bid $50. Who give 100? I'm on 100. Who give 100? I'm bid 50. Now $100. Who give 100? I'm bid 250. Now 300. 250. Would you get 3? 250. Would you get 300? I'm on 3. Would you get 3? 3. Would you get 300? 250. Did you get 3? Did you get 3? 3. Did you get 300? I'm on 3. Would you get 300? 250, 300, now 50. I'm at 300, want to bid 50. 300, want to bid 50, da da bum, 50, 50, to get 50, da da bum, 350. I'm at 300, want to bid $50. 350, 350. I'm at $1,000, now 1,100. I'm at 1,000, who give 1,100? $1,000, 1,100, 1,200, 1,300. I'm at 12, 13, to get 13, to get 1,300. I'm at 12, 13. I'm at 1,200, want to bid 13, to get 13, to get 13, to get 1,300. I'm at 1,200, 1,300, 1,200, 1,300, 13, everybody get 13, everybody get 1,300. I'm at 1,200, 1,300, anybody else? I'm at 1,200, 1,300, it's a great package. Season tickets, parking space, you've got it all. I'm at 1,200, 1,200's a bid, 1,500, 1,600, 15, want to bid 1,600, 15, want to bid 16, 1,600 out of the bone, did you get 1,600 out of the bone, 16? I'm at 15, 16, $1,600 bid. Am I at a moment? 1,600, 1,500's a bid. Who gives 1,600? Anybody else? Give 1,600. I'm at 15, now 16. 15, want to bid 1,600. 15, want to bid 16. Anybody else? If you're done, I have to be. I'm at 1,550, now 1,600. 1,550, thank you, Eric. 1,600. I'm at 1,550, now 1,600. 1,550, 1,600. 1,650, now 17. 1,650, Eric, it's your turn. I'm at 1,650, 1,700. 1,650, now 17. Did he get 17? Did he get 1,700? I'm at 1,650, want to bid 1,700. 1,700 is what I'm looking for. 1650 is the current bid, and I'm at 1650, want to bid 1700. 1700. 1650, want to bid 17? Eric, you still have time, but not much. I'm at $1,650, want to give 1700. 1700, last call, 1700, one more time, and I have sold it, $1,650. Thank you for all the great bidders. $1,650. Now, if GiveSmart could roll us over for item number 303 is the next item. And thank you. This is Lake Monroe Pontoon Party Barge. This is the Lake Monroe Pontoon Party Barge. Pontoon. A lot of fun can have here. Bring your friends and your swimsuits. Absolutely. Get ready to enjoy an all-day fresh air adventure on our beautiful Lake Monroe. This exciting package features this features an 8-hour rental of a 34-foot double-decker pontoon boat. Sit back and relax, or channel your inner kid as you make your way down the slide from the top of this great boat into the lake. All right, bid here. I've got 100, now 200. I'm at 100, now 250, 300. Anybody else? I'm at 300, 350. Anybody out there can play. Y'all like to go to the lake, and what a great opportunity this is. And I'm at $300, 350. 300, now 50. What'd you get for there? You'd have to get 350. Now 400. I'm at 350, now 4. 350, now 4. What'd you get 4? 4, what'd you get 4? 4, what'd you get 400? 400. 400. I'm at 350. Want to get 4? Last call at $400. There's a $50 gift certificate in this. $50 gift certificate for BJ's. So there we go, $500. So there's a $50 gift card in there for BJ's. 500, who get 550? 500, now 50. I'm at 500, wanna bid 50, da 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 bum, 550 till you get 550, wanna bid 550. I'm at 500, wanna bid 550 till you get 550 till you get 550. I'm at 500, wanna bid 550. Last call, and I have sold it, $500, sold it, $500. All right, next item, if GiveSmart would pull it up for us, is item number 304, and this is the naming rights to the WonderLab Beehive for 1 year. You're going to have the opportunity to name, it's for the first time ever. WonderLab is offering you the opportunity to sponsor our beloved beehives, our honeybees, with this sponsorship. The winner will have the exclusive naming rights for January 1 through December 31, 2021. So jump in here right now. Lot 304 should be coming up on your screen. And we're right now at $250. Who give $300? 300. I'm at 250. Now 3. 250 till you get 300. Now 50. I'm at 300. Want to bid 350. I'm at 300. Want to bid 350. 300 to get 350. Da da da. 350 to get 350. I'm at 300 only. Who get 350? Who wants their name by the beehive, for the beehives, for the year, or your naming rights? 300, 350. I'm at 300. Want to bid 350. Nobody get 350. 100, 300, 500, 50. I'm at 500. Now 50. That's a way to jump them up. 500's a bid. Want to bid 550. Did you get 550? Nobody get 550. 500's a bid now. 50 da 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 bum. 50, 50. Nobody get 501. 550. I'm bid 501. 550. I'm bid 501. 550. Did you get 50 da 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 bum? 50. Nobody get $50. Who get 550? 550. 500. Now 50. Now 600. I'm bid 5.5. Now 600. I'm bid 550. Now 600. I'm bid 550. You ready to get $600 bid? I'm 600. Now 50. I'm bid 600. Now $50 bid. I'm buying you a bomb at 600. Now 50. I'm bid 600. Want to bid $50? I'm bid 600. Now 50. Want to bid 50? 700. Thank you. 750. I'm bid 700. Now 50. I'm bid 700. Now 50. $750. Where? 750. Now 800. I'm at 750. Now 800. 800 to get 800. I'm at $750. Now 800. Bid 800 to me. Bid 800. Now 50. I'm at 800. Now 50. First time ever you're going to get a name the rights to the bees. 800. 850. 800 to get 850. To get 850. $850. Thank you. $1,000. Now $1,100. $1,000. $1,100. I'm at 1,000, everybody get 1,100. $1,000, 1,100. I'm at 1,000, 1,100, 1,000. What's that? 1,001. Let's make it 1,100. 1,000, now 1,100. 1,000, now 1,100. Make it 1,100. I'm at 1,000, now 2,000, now 2,500. That's a way to make it. That's a way to work it. I'm at 2,000. Because listen, folks, yes, you're going to name the beehive, but you're helping the kids. You're helping WonderLab. We're going to keep WonderLab great the way it is. We're at 2,000. Who give 2,100? 2,000. Who give 2,100? 2,000. We're going to get 21. Want to buy them at 21. We're going to get 2,100. 2,000. We're going to get 21. I like the way you're thinking. 3,000. Now 3,500. I'm at 3,000. Would you get 35? I'm at 3,000. Want to bid 3,500. I'm at 3,000. Want to bid 35. Did he get 35? Did he get 35? Did he get 3,500? I'm at 3,000. Want to bid 35? 3,000. Want to bid 35? 3,000. Want to bid 35? Just keep following suit here, okay? Right now, you know if you're in, you know if you're not in, but it's your turn to bump it to 3,500. I'm at 3,000. Let's go 3,500. Help WonderLab. Thank you, 3,500. Now 4,000. I'm at 3,500. Now 4. 3,500. Now 4. 3,500. Now 4. Did he get 4? 4. Everybody get 4,000. Da da da. 4. Everybody get 4. 4. Everybody get 4,000. I'm at 3,500, 4,000, 4,000, 4,000, 4,000, 3,500, 3,500, 3,500, everybody get 4,000, 4,000 where? I'm at 3,500, want to bid 4, to get 4,000, thank you, now 45. I'm at 4,000, now 45, 4,000, now 45. I'm at 4,000, now 45, everybody get 45, 45, 5, 5, 5, everybody get 45. I'm at 4,000, to get 45. 4,000, did he get 45? Did he get 45? Give me 45. Let's see this thing blow the top off. We're doing good. Let's keep it going. 4,000, 4,500. I'm at 4,000, want to bid 45. I'm at 4,000, want to bid 45. 42 will work in 45. I'm at 42, 45. 42, 45, did he get 45? 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 42, 45. 45. 45, everybody get 45. We're not done. I can feel it in the air. 42, 45. Thank you, 45. Now 47, 50. I'm at 45, 47 and a half. I'm at 45. Who get 47, 50? 45, 47 and a half. Did he get 47, 50? 45, did he get 47, 50? 45, 47, 50. 45, 47, 50. Don't lose your chance to be the first ever. I'm at 45. Who get 47? 45, 47. 45, 47, you get 47. I'm at 45, 47. I'm at 45, everybody get 47. I'm watching my screen, I'm giving you time. 46, 50, I'd have never thought about that number. Who get 4,800? I'm at 46, 50. Who get 4,800? 46, 50. Who get 4,800? 48, 48, 4,800. I'm at 46, 50, 4,800. 48, did he get 48? Did he get 48? Hey, here's an idea. Somebody round this up to an even $5,000. Let's go to $5,000. What do you think, Doc? Don't you think that'd be a good thing, dude? Yeah, he's shaking his head. Yes, he's behind a mask, but I can see the shake. Thank you for $5,000. Who give 5,500? 5,000, did he get 500? 5,000, 5,500? 5,000, everybody get 5,500. Anywhere else? Last call for 5,500. 5,000, where'd you get 5,500? And I have sold it, sold it, sold it for $5,000. The naming rights to the wonderful WonderLab Beehive. There we go, right there. Ladies and gentlemen, that does it for the live auction items. And I'll be right back with you here in a few minutes, and we're going to top off the hour with, we've got another climber coming in. I hear that she is fast. We're going to see. And we're going to finish off the evening with the rest of Fund to Need. Jump in there. Make your donations. We're climbing for that 50,000 mark.
And speaking of climbing, it'll be our third and final contestant on the Grapevine Challenge tonight. Molly Kate started us off at 45 seconds. The Doc, Price McKee, went at 44 seconds. And now it is the horse for the course. The Leprous, if you will. Ella Heckman. Ella, how many times have you climbed the Grapevine? Hundreds. The pressure is on, just like the Kentucky Derby last Saturday, the biggest favorite in 31 years. You don't feel any pressure. We'll count it down. 3, 2, 1, and away she goes. 44 seconds is the number to beat, and she is moving adroitly through the Grapevine Challenge. She is already halfway to it, slinking and snaking her way. No shoes, no problem. As she moves up, she's skipping stages. This is not her first time, folks, as she mentioned, as she crawls under and over, and one more turn for home, and down the stretch she comes. Ella rings the bell. We'll have to check our time to see who the fastest climber was tonight in the Grapevine Challenge.
Hi everybody, I hope you're enjoying Science Night In. My name is Asha, I work as an engineer at Cook Medical, and I also serve on the board of directors at WonderLab. I first got involved with WonderLab a few years ago when I started volunteering at STEM Sundays. I think STEM Sundays are a great example of what WonderLab does so well, which is take a science or engineering concept and make it simple and fun through a hands-on activity. When WonderLab closed its doors due to the pandemic in March, STEM Sunday continued online in a virtual format, and I was so impressed and inspired by how the magic of science and engineering continued using simple household materials. So I was inspired by that to do a little at-home science with you tonight. And of course, we're going to focus on the science of sound. So at its most basic level, sound is a wave, and that wave is governed by one very simple equation: frequency is equal to velocity divided by wavelength. So frequency is probably the thing we interact with most with sound, because it's what we hear. It's the beautiful melody you sing along to. It's what you start manipulating when you're playing an instrument. On the other side of the equation, we have velocity. And this is actually very simple. It is the speed of sound through air. And so that's going to be a constant because, well, we're always hearing sound through air. Then we're going to divide that velocity by wavelength. Wavelength is where it gets interesting. So imagine a wave, if you will, and wavelength is the distance between the peaks of that wave. Now, let's say you have a big, long wave. You're going to have a large distance between your peaks, so you're going to have a large wavelength value. And when you divide the speed of sound through air by that large value, you're going to get a low value as your frequency. And then you're going to get a low pitch, a low note that you hear. Now, on the opposite side, let's imagine a really short wave. So that is going to have short little distances between peaks, and therefore you're going to have a small wavelength value. So again, divide velocity of sound through air by a small value. Now you're going to get a large number for your frequency. You're going to get a high frequency, which means a high note. Now, I hope that this mathematically makes sense, but don't worry, because we're actually going to see it. Let's build a slide whistle, and so you can manipulate wavelength on your own and see how it affects frequency. So what I want you to do is dig into the goodie box you got from WonderLab, and inside there's going to be a brown paper bag that has a couple components in that. And we're going to look at what those are, starting with a piece of 3/4 inch PVC pipe, a 3/4 inch wooden dowel rod, a PVC connector piece, a short little wooden dowel piece with some tape at the end, a little foam circle that has double stick tape on one side, and then finally a little piece of wax paper with some tape on it. So to begin building our whistle, start with the PVC pipe. This is going to form the body of our whistle, and at one end you see that there's a channel cut out, and that's where our mouthpiece goes. So take your short little wooden block with the tape and insert it tape end first into where that channel is. and only push it up until the tape. Then, take your PVC connector piece and slide it on top. And now, let's see if this makes a noise. Okay, I don't know what yours sounds like, but mine sounds a little weak. We could make this sound better. So I'm going to take off the connector, and I'm going to take off the wooden dowel, and you'll notice this is pretty loose. I can turn it, and that means it's not tight enough. This needs to be really tight and form an airtight seal. So to fix that, I'm going to remove this piece, take my piece of wax paper and peel off the tape, and wrap this around just, you know, until the tape is gone. There we go. And now this should have a tighter fit. Yes, it is a lot tighter. It's actually hard for me to insert now, and that's perfect. So again, I'm inserting to the depth of the tape. Nice and tight seal, does not rotate around. And then I'm taking my PVC connector piece and sliding it on top. When I do that, I'm making sure that the edge of the PVC connector comes down to just about the edge of where the tape ends. I want those to be at about the same place. All right, so I look like I did that. Let's try it again. Okay, that sounds much better now. So let's turn this normal whistle into a sliding whistle. Take your piece of foam and peel off the double stick tape. And then choose any end of your wooden dowel and stick the foam on. Try to make sure it's nice and centered, just like that. And then this is going to act as our plunger. So go ahead and stick this foam piece through the other end of your whistle. And you should feel that be able to slide nice and smoothly and easily inside. And now we'll test if this works as a slide whistle. Awesome. And now you see we've proven the relationship between wavelength and frequency. When I stick my slide plunger all the way out here, this entire length of the whistle is available for the sound to resonate. And that means I'm setting a longer wavelength. So again, I'm going to get that low frequency note. If I move the slide whistle up, I'm setting a shorter length, a shorter wavelength, and now I'm going to get that higher frequency. And now you see how that works. So now you have a fun whistle that you can play around with to see the relationship between frequency and wavelength. This is something you can experiment with at home, see what songs you can make up, maybe even build it in different PVC lengths. So I hope that you have fun with this activity. I hope that you learned a little bit more about the science of sound. And I just want to say thank you so much for your support of WonderLab. Have a good rest of your night.
The thing I like most about science is that science can help us understand the mysteries of the world. And it can help us, and it can help us find a way to cure this pandemic. And why science is important is because without science, everybody would just be, well, you know, dumb.
I like science because it's everything, and because I like space and rockets.
Hi, my name is Arya, and I wanted to share what I love about science. I like science because I get to learn stuff that I didn't know. And I also like the Wonder Lab because it's just so cool, and there's like the magnetic water and like the parachute thing. And I like to catch the parachutes. And I also like the building thing that you can build it with screws, and you have the hats. And I also like when you grab the block with a crane and you put it on top of another one. Bye.
Greetings from my home to you in your home. Hope you're enjoying tonight. I wanted to talk about why the Wonder Lab is meaningful to me. I started my relationship with the Wonder Lab actually as a volunteer in the museum. Upon moving to Bloomington, I knew nobody and was looking for something to do. And I had attended a WonderLab gala and I thought it was wonderful and it piqued my interest and it seemed like it was really a staple in the community. And so I met Jean and Diane, and if you know them, then you know exactly how wonderful they are and how great they are at making the museum a place that is inviting for young people to volunteer and also for young people to attend. And that was a little home away from home. I felt really welcomed. I learned a lot. It's amazing what kids science will teach you and remind you of things that you learned so long ago, and some new things too. And from then, I went on to become a CASA, and that was a little heavier, working with children who are at risk of being abused or neglected. And the WonderLab in that case was always a place where you could see kids bloom, where they would open up and they would get to be free. They would get to play and they would get to use their mind and explore. And it was really, really wonderful. Such a gift. And as time passed, I had my own children, and that's something that I really wish for them, to have the freedom to be creative, to explore, to experiment, to fail, to succeed, to keep persevering. And I think that's born out of a curious spirit and a sense of wonder. And that's something that the WonderLab provides. I see it in my own children. I see it on field trips. I'm looking forward to going back on field trips as soon as possible when it's safe to do so. It's just a wonderful place. It's a treasure that we have in our community and an opportunity that I think is so important for kids of all ages and socioeconomic levels to be able to attend. And that's a reason that my husband Gavin and I feel so strongly about donating our dollars every year, because it supports something that's meaningful and tangible and beloved. I hope you'll join me tonight in supporting WonderLab and raising some funds for something that is totally Bloomington and wonderful.
Hey, we're back here with you now, and a lot of fun things going on tonight. I know you're having a lot of fun out there at home and in your little watch parties, you know, your small group watch parties, and we appreciate it. WonderLab appreciates it. We've still got a big hurdle. We've got a big bridge and a gap to bridge. So we told you earlier that we're in the middle of that 30 minute, and that's now bumped into, we're at 45 minutes. That's okay. That's okay. We're still pushing to raise that $50,000. Now, we're still looking for a $5,000 donor. We've got Dr. Steiner sitting out there. He's ready, but he needs you to help push him. He's gonna match with $5,000. We need you to match. We need you to give $5,000. We've got a board match of $3,000. So if you can jump on right now, we've got a board match of $3,000, doctor's match of $5,000. We got word a little bit ago that we think we've got someone there ready to meet up with that $5,000 match, but we're still watching for it. So if you can get on your tablet right now, you should have just gotten a new link moments ago. They had a couple little technical difficulties. You know how the interweb is. You know, things get tangled up in there sometimes. So, but we got that straightened out, we believe. So go on that link, donate to the fund in need. We're looking for that 50,000. Now, a lot of cool things are happening in here. Phones are ringing sometimes. I see them picking up the phones. It's not ringing like the old school phones. I kind of wish we had that phone bank, you know, Jerry's Kids behind us. You know, I watched that as a kid so often. Well, this is WonderLab's Kids, okay? WonderLab's Kids. So I wish you could hear the phone ringing. We're looking for matches. We've got the $5,000 sitting out there to match. Hey, I believe we just got that $5,000 match, did we?
Julie Paris
gave the $5,000 match. So Dr. Steiner, you're not off the hook. We appreciate you both greatly. So we got the $5,000 match we was looking for. But now, while we were off the air, while I was off the air there a minute ago, we got another surprise. We have got a major donor. A major donor, big heart, ability, and a lover of WonderLab has offered to match not $5,000, $50,000. We've got a $50,000 match that has come in. So we've got to get you up. We've got to get this up to that $50,000 mark where our goal is. And then that's going to make us $100,000. Okay? So help us get to that $50,000. We're short of it right now, but we're climbing. With that match, that helped a bunch. So if you can give $3,000 to help match for that board match, give $3,000 right now. If you can help us out right now at $3,000 level, just reach up there and touch that button and put in $3,000, and that's going to help us reach that. We don't want to give up that $50,000 match. So help us make this 50, and then we're going to get did I just see a $3,000 match come through? I think I saw a $3,000 match. $3,000. All right, let's just back this down a little bit. Go to $1,000. I know we've got over 220 people or so watching us here tonight, maybe more. That's how many is registered right now on the tablets. So if you can give $1,000, if you can help WonderLab, help the community kids to be able to have the science opportunity that WonderLab brings, text the button or touch the button to donate your $1,000. Put $1,000. Thank you, donor. There it just jumped up by $1,000. So can somebody else give us another $1,000? I'm watching you here on the tablet. We need another $1,000 donor. Don't forget, we're looking for 50 total. We've got a match. Thank you. There went another $1,000. Thank you. Thank you for being a donor for another $1,000. We're still a little short, but we're getting there. I know that you're working at it on your end, but let's go ahead and give you another second to give $1,000 to WonderLab. How about we jump to $500? Who can help us out at the $500 level? Let's go ahead and give $500. We've got another match from the board. The board of directors has gotten someone else that said they'll give a $500 match. There's another $1,000. Thank you for your 500s. Everybody jump in. If you couldn't give $1,000, let's go ahead and give $500. And we've got a board match of $500. Help us out. Just get on your tablet, your phone. Everyone's got a smartphone nowadays. Mine's sitting here. I don't know whether to look at my smartphone or my tablet. Looking at the tablet because it's a little bigger. Hey, there we go, another $1,000. It's jumping up there. Can you give 500? Someone else give 500. Help the kids at WonderLab. Another $500, please. My tablet just timed out on me. That went away. All right. Got it back up here on my phone. How about $250? Who can help us out at $250? Anybody out there? Give us $250. We're climbing up that ladder, just kind of like everyone's climbed up the beanstalk here. We're climbing up that financial ladder. We just got a $2,500 donation. Thank you. Thank you to the Rothrock family. Man, you talk about good supporters. And she was here the other day during rehearsal. She's done a fabulous job here through WonderLab. So there's another $2,500. So we're still climbing. So if you've got $250 to give out there, let's put it on your tablet. You know, we realize everyone has different abilities. Everyone has different abilities. Everyone has different wherewithal. Here's what we understand. Every dollar counts. Every dollar toward WonderLab helps the kids of the community have that science experience that WonderLab brings. So,
can you read the text to donate number?
Say what?
Read out the text to donate number. Where to text to donate?
I don't have any idea.
76278.
So, to donate, a text donate is 7. Hang on. 76278. Text to donate 76278. So if you didn't have that text number, now you can go back and you can text in 5,000, 3,000, 10,000, 500, 250. It doesn't matter. Jump right in there. We're climbing right up that ladder. We're trying to get to that 50,000 threshold because we have a major donor at 50,000. We've met a lot of matches here tonight. We've met the $5,000 match.
Tell everyone the silent auction is closing exactly at 8:30.
The silent auction, I've been informed, the silent auction will be closing at exactly 8:30. So you've got, looks like about 4.5 minutes. 4.5 minutes to bid on the silent auction. Just got a couple minutes left on the fund a need, and we're going to wrap it up.
We
just got $250 from Vaughn Welsh. Thank you. And jump right in there. If you've got $250 that you can spare, let's put it toward WonderLab here this evening. We're having a great event. Amy and all the staff here at WonderLab have really poured it out the last few months gearing up for this. And as we all know, everyone across America, the world has been affected by COVID. That has changed the way we do everything, including the gala. And we appreciate you having the host families, having your watch parties, and we appreciate each and every one of you for being out there that are here with us in virtual. But you still have an opportunity to donate. You've got about 3 minutes left on your silent auction, and we're going to leave the fundraising, the fund a need donation button, we're going to leave it open for a few minutes after I leave the air. We're going to leave it open so you can continue to give. It's climbing. It's sitting here climbing. I'm watching it. You guys are doing great. Just keep giving money and helping WonderLab. You got about 2.5 minutes left to bid on your silent auction, so take care of that. Bid on the fund to need. Help us reach that 50,000 mark, and we've still got time to do that yet this evening. So with that, I'm going to turn it over, and we'll get things closed out here. But Jimmy Dean Coffee from United Country Real Estate, I want to thank each and every one of you for allowing me to be here again to be a part of this great event. Thank you. God bless.
Thank you, everyone. This has been an amazing event. Whew, and I feel like it's not over yet. There's donations still coming in, and we're tracking those. to see what our final total is for the evening. Thank you all for your generosity. Before I sign off, I just want to say a special thank you to everyone who made all of the different parts come together here. And that is Deirdre, Beth, Hunter, Rick, Asha, and Adam for all of your parts in making this event happen. So tonight we made, it's coming up on $30,000, and there'll be some additional monies coming in. So cross your fingers that we can meet that match. The donation link is still live. We're really hoping to get that huge $50,000 match contribution. So please help us get there. One more thing, and that is that if you won one of tonight's auction items, WonderLab will be in touch with you to arrange a delivery that works for you. So now, have a wonderful rest of your evening. Thank you so much, and good night.